We'll start with the basics of fundus fluorescein angiography in this lecture. The fundamental principle of FFA is sodium fluorescein is a hydrocarbon that responds to light energy between 465 and 490 nanometer and fluoresces at a wavelength of 520 to 530 nanometer. So if a blue light is directed to unbound sodium fluorescein, it emits a light that appears green-yellow. This slide shows the absorption and emission curves of the sodium fluorescein dye. The equipments and materials needed for angiography are as follows: fundus camera, meshed fluorescein filters, a digital processing unit and a user interface, 23 gauge scalp vein needle, 5 ml of 10% fluorescein solution, 5 ml syringes, 1 inch needle to draw the dye, armrest for fluorescein injection, tourniquets, alcohol swab, bandage and standard emergency equipment. The steps of angiography are, as with any procedure, we begin with a written informed consent. As it is an invasive procedure, we'll dilate both eyes and check both the eyes of the patient, enter patient data on the machine, give proper position to the patient, rule out auto and pseudofluorescence. The color and the red-free photographs are taken first. We start with recording of the eye of interest. With the filters in place, the first photo is taken at start of injection of the dye. The second photo is taken at the exact finish of the injection. Then we take at regular intervals of 1 to 2 seconds till the veins are full of the dye. This is followed by pictures at 5, 7, 10 and 15 minutes. All the while we will observe the patient for possible reactions to the fluorescein dye. At the end of the procedure, we explain to the patient that the urine will be discolored for a day or so. Side effects and complications of the procedure. The common complications are extravasation and local tissue necrosis and thrombophlebitis treated with ice pack application and thrombophob ointment, nausea vomiting which occurs due to fast injection of the dye and goes away in a minute or two, vasovagal reaction, allergic reaction like hives and itching which is treated with Avil. The rarer complications are anaphylaxis and respiratory problems, circulatory shock, MI, nerve palsy, inadvertent arterial injection, neurological problems, pyrexia and very rarely death. A normal angiogram has 5 phases, the pre-arterial or choroidal phase, an arterial phase, arterial venous phase and the recirculation phase. In the normal angiogram, the first fluorescence begins in the choroid 10 to 12 seconds after injection of the dye and this is faint, patchy and irregularly scattered throughout the posterior fundus. The cilioretinal artery begins to fill in this phase. Within 1 to 3 seconds after choroidal fluorescence, the central retinal artery begins to fill with the dye. The fluorescein flows into the retinal arteries, then into the pre-capillary arterioles, the capillaries, the post-capillary venules and finally the retinal veins. Because the fluorescein from the venules enters the veins along their walls, the flow in the veins is laminar. The vascular flow in the center is darker because this is non-fluorescent blood which comes from the periphery and takes longer to fluoresce. In the next 5 to 10 seconds, fluorescence of the two parallel laminae becomes thicker. In the next 5 to 10 seconds, as the fluorescein filling increases in the veins, the laminae enlarge and meet, resulting in complete fluorescence of the retinal veins. Fluorescence of the disc emanates from the posterior ciliary vascular system, both from the edge of the disc and from the tissue between the center and circumference of the disc. The healthy disc tissue contains many capillaries and the disc becomes fairly hyperfluorescent on the angiogram. Interpretation of an abnormal angiogram. It could be an abnormal fluorescence which is hypo or hyper. Hypofluorescence is absence or reduction of the normal fluorescence and hyperfluorescence is an abnormal excessive fluorescence. Hypofluorescence is either a blocked fluorescence or it is due to a vascular filling defect. The key to differentiating between the two is to correlate with the color. When fluorescein is present but it is not seen due to an overlying blocking material, which could be blood or pigment or fluid, then it is blocked fluorescence. While in a filling defect, the fluorescein is not present and so it is not seen. Opacification of the cornea, anterior chamber, lens, vitreous and anterior part of the retina and disc will lead to blocking of both the retinal and the choroidal fluorescence. As you can see, the blocking material will correlate in size and shape to the blocked fluorescence. Any material, whether it is blood, pigment or lipofuscin, in the deep retinal or subretinal space will lead to blocked choroidal fluorescence. You can see the normal filling of the dye in the retinal vessels above it. This is showing blocked fluorescence due to pigment. When it is a retinal vascular filling defect, we have to determine whether it is the obstruction of a retinal artery, a vein, a capillary bed or a combination of these. As you can see here, it is a branch retinal vein obstruction along with capillary non-perfusion. When we have choroidal vascular filling defect, there is atrophy of the RPE and the small choriocapillaries. So there is absence of the normal ground glass effect of the choroidal fluorescence, and we can see the large choroidal vessels. When we want to quantify the vein occlusions as ischemic or non-ischemic, we have to calculate the areas of non-perfusion in disc diameters. Vascular filling defects at the disc occur due to failure of the capillaries of the optic nerve head to fill, and this is commonly seen in cases of a disc coloboma or optic disc pit. There are four possible causes of abnormal hypofluorescence: pre-injection, transmitted, abnormal vessels and leakage. Pre-injection fluorescence is hyperfluorescence which can be seen before the dye is injected. It is caused either by structures that naturally fluoresce, that is an astrocytic hematoma or disc drusen, which is known as autofluorescence, or due to mismatched filters, that is pseudofluorescence. Transmitted fluorescence is an increase in visibility of the normal choroidal fluorescence due to absence or decrease of pigment in the pigment epithelium. It has four basic characteristics. It appears early, increases in intensity as the dye increases in the choroid, does not increase in size or shape during the late phase of angiography, and tends to fade and disappear as the choroid empties of dye. Changes in the retinal vasculature can be classified as follows. First is neovascularization. This neovascular frond, it may be present on the disc or it may be present elsewhere in the retina. It will fill up with dye, and in the late stages it will leak fluorescein from the abnormal vessels, and it will lead to a fuzzy cotton ball like appearance over the area of neovascularization. Microaneurysms fill up with the dye in the AV phase. The number of microaneurysms seen on the FFA will be more than that which can be seen clinically. In some cases, you can see the formation of collaterals or anastomotic channels. As you can remember, retinal arteries are end arteries and they do not anastomose or normally. But in certain pathological conditions, they can cross the horizontal raphe and form collaterals. In some cases, we can see abnormal dilatation of the capillaries known as telangiectasia, which will fill up with the dye and give a light bulb like appearance. When subretinal or choroidal neovascularization is present, the early angiogram shows a lacy, irregular and nodular hypofluorescence. The dye empties completely from the retinal and choroidal vasculature about 10 to 15 minutes after injection. Any fluorescence after that is abnormal leakage, except at the disc margin, lamina fibrosa and the sclera. When the leakage is severe, the extracellular fluid may flow into the cystic pockets and the angiogram will show fluorescence of the cystic spaces, giving rise to a petaloid pattern at the macula. Fluorescent staining of non-cystoid edema is diffuse and irregular. Leaking of the large retinal vessels can be seen in inflammation, that is perivasculitis, traction, severe pulling on a large retinal vessel, and occlusion. In case of optic disc edema, in the late phases, the dilated capillaries on the disc leak, leading to fuzzy fluorescence of the disc margin. Pulling is defined as leakage of fluorescein in a distinct anatomic space. In CSR, the pooling of dye under the sensory retinal detachment takes place slowly. Whereas if the leakage is from a choroidal neovascular membrane, it is profuse and complete. The pooling under a PED extends to the edges of the detachment and makes the entire detachment and its margin hyperfluorescent and clearly visible. Staining is leakage of dye into the tissue or material. Drusens display late hyperfluorescence due to staining. The larger the drusen, more likely they will retain the fluorescence and staining will occur. Scar tissue retains fluorescein and demonstrates well-demarcated hyperfluorescence. Thank you for your patient hearing and a very special thank you to Master Swayam for allowing me to record this lecture. And a last line from him.
Thank you very much, and finish!